I want you all to meet a young man here. This is Matthew Wood. Matthew, that was a time when I was bigger than Matthew. I think I was 26 and he was 7 months, I think. But anyway, Matthew, I want you all to get to know Matthew here. I just want him to take just a little bit, all right? And this is Matthew Woods, his precious wife. I hadn't met his wife as yet, Rachel. And he has two daughters now, Annie and Lydia. But the reason I want y'all to meet him is because he was a member of my church as a teenager. And I remember him sitting there, and he'd zero in on the Word of God. And God moved upon his heart, and he came down to surrender to God for full-time Christian service while he was a member of my church. His mom was a single mom and has yet another brother. And they were members of our church. And God has begun to do wonderful things in Matthew's life. And I want you all to just let him, I want him to let you know what he's doing now. Because it's my desire in our ministry, in some of the loose change that we have, to support men just like this, okay? Who are out there doing it, all right? Okay.
How are you guys doing this morning? As Kenny was saying, I came up in his church and received the call in a full-time ministry when Kenny was at Christ Community at the Savannah Baptist Center. And, you know, I never knew where this was going to go. I went off to college, played football, thought I was going to play football professionally, and just didn't end up working out. And God called me to seminary. Went on to seminary and thought I was going to be a youth pastor. The first month I was there, every guy I talked to, guess what they were going to be? A youth pastor. They had the same idea as me. And so I started praying. I said, hey, God, change their hearts. Change their hearts. And that's the biggest no-no you can ever do. Because guess what? God will change yours. And that's exactly what he did. He introduced me to my wife, who was off at college at App State. And I was going to Southeastern Baptist Seminary there in Wake Forest, North Carolina. And met her, started just praying and seeking the Lord. And he opened my eyes up, pulled back this veil for missions. I was like, all right, God, well, I'll go and I'll plant a church somewhere in New England or in Montana, somewhere like that. I'll do missions in that way. And God said, you know, he kind of let me sit in that and kind of marinate in that for a little bit. And then he said, hey, wait a minute, that's not far enough. I said, well, how far do you want me to go, God? And he said, I want you to go really far. I want you to go to some of the darkest places, the hardest places to get to. And where he took us was Papua New Guinea. How many of you know where Papua New Guinea is?
I don't.
Not many. Not many. Papua New Guinea is a small Pacific Island country, South Pacific Island country, right above Australia. Thanks to America and Australia, or actually more so thanks to America, we kept the Japanese out of Australia. There, the Marines did.
Yeah.
Praise God for that. But that's if people know where Papua New Guinea is, it's usually associated with World War II. And thank God for World War II, because guess what? It opened up opportunities for missionaries like me to go to some of the hardest places to get to in the jungle, because America created airstrips and stuff like that when we went in and we did bombings and basically forced Japan off the island of Papua New Guinea. Now, what do we do in Papua New Guinea? We do Bible translation. Why do we do Bible translation? Well, there's 850 languages in Papua New Guinea. Now, we're not talking like, you know, the population of the English-speaking nations. No, no, no. We're talking like 1,000 speakers. Maybe a little bit less, some a little bit more. But we're talking minority language groups. We're talking language groups that are trying to read the English Bible. But hey, you know, I was driving down here, I was listening to a song by Hillsong United. And in that song, they talked about how the veil was pulled back. But the problem is when a people group or a language group does not have the Bible in their language, it's like the veil is there again. So what we're doing is, hey, we're pulling that veil of language away. And people were able to read the Word of God in their language. Imagine if we didn't have the Bible in English. Would we be here? Probably not. What would our understanding, what would our walk with Christ be like? So that's why we're going. That's why we're doing Bible translation. We want people to be able to read the Word of God. We want the church to grow. We want discipleship to take place. We want to plant churches. That's what we want to do. And you cannot do that without the Word of God. So me and my wife are serving in Papua New Guinea. We go back in August of this year. We got some training we're going to do in February in Dallas, and then we hope to go back. The only thing that's keeping us from going back is our the level of partnership that we have to be at before we can go. And so we ask that you pray about that for us. that you pray for our translators that we're working with. We're working with 10 languages there in Papua New Guinea. We ask that you pray for our 20 translators as they're working on Mark this month. Mark chapter 4 through 6. Pray for their families as they leave their villages. We've got a lot that you can pray for. I'd love to talk with you more. I don't want to take all of Kenny's time. But come up to me afterwards. I'll stick around. I'll talk to you till this evening. How long you got? I'll share my passion. I'll share my heart. So thank you guys. Thank you. All right, yeah.
That's slightly more important than Ohio State and Oregon, isn't it? I mean, it's more important than the NFC AFC playoffs this weekend. I mean, these people over there this month, we're talking about Super Bowls and playoffs, and they're talking about Mark 4 through 6. See? So guys, we got to be aware that we have missionaries like this called. You know, I'm going to tell you, I know it's Mama Carrie. I know what she wants. She wants for those grand youngers to grow up right there in Charleston, right there around her. But they're going to be gone on the other side of the world. See, carrying the gospel. Thank God that God does that. Amen. Amen. He raised up right in the church, right from among us. Right? He doesn't have a missionary factory out on the inner town cranking out missionaries. The church, the local church is where God gets his missionaries. And thank God for that. Thank God for that. All right. Turn to Genesis. Genesis chapter number 25. This most interesting chapter in the Word of God. Here in this chapter, we see the death of our old friend Abraham. We've been walking with Abraham. We've been learning a little bit about the walk with God, a walk of faith. Right? A walk that depends upon obedience to the Word of God, putting the foot of faith on the promise of God and just keep on going, just plodding out, walking with God. And we have walked with Abraham, and now we come to chapter number 25, and our friend Abraham now dies, and he is going from this land to the other land. He has gathered together to his people in verse number 8. And the story picks up after it talks about Abraham. It also talks about the death of his oldest son, Ishmael. But it also talks about the birth of 6 more of his sons through a handmaid named Keturah, one of his concubine, Keturah. And so it gives us So we gather ourselves and find out what's going on. Abraham dies. Ishmael dies. There's 6 more boys that were born to Abraham. But then remember now, we have Isaac. And Isaac's story starts in verse number 20. Isaac's story now, you see, is connected to the end of Abraham's story. Chapter number 26 is really the only single chapter that is all about Isaac, all right? In chapter number 27, we see Isaac and his boys, moreover, but chapter number 26, we see Isaac and his business. Isaac's business was digging wells. And in digging these wells, we see some significance about spiritual progress, and we'll look at that when we get to that. Well, in chapter 25 now, we're talking about Isaac and his bride, all right? Isaac and his bride, Isaac and his business, and next, Isaac and his boys, all right? Now, when we looked at Isaac and his bride, we're going to see here that verse number 20, Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah to wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian, of Padan Aram, the sister of Laban, the Syrian. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife because she was barren, and the Lord was entreated of him, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived. Now, remember our point last week that God will often use our prayers as a means to accomplish his will. God's will always was that Isaac to have a wife. He told Abraham that Isaac was going to be, the blessing was going to come through his son Isaac. Isaac was going to have children. So God's grand design was for Isaac to have a wife, and yet now he has a wife, and she has no children. Well, we know God's desire was for him to have children. And yet God uses Isaac's own prayer to accomplish God's will. And we don't know exactly how, because the question comes up, I mean, if God already knows what he wants to do and what he's going to do, then why should I pray at all? And sometimes these things seem like mysteries, but the truth of the matter is the Bible teaches both of them. The Bible teaches that God is a sovereign God who has a predetermined counsel and will, and what God desires and what God ultimately wants is going to happen. Y'all believe that, right? That's the sovereignty of God. And yet, at the same time, there is a place where man enters into it and where we pray. And the Bible makes it clear that this woman had a child because Isaac prayed for her. Right? But now, at the same time, I can absolutely say without any stutter or stammer that she had a child because that was God's will for her to have a child. And he had said that way back in Abraham's day. How do these two things work? Well, they work together. You see, I'll just tell you this. I know prayer is more than me getting what I want. Prayer is me lining my heart up with the heart of God. Right? So it's so much like Jesus taught us to pray, not my will, but what? Thine will be done. Hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done. Right? Thy will be done. So this is the will of God being done, and yet Isaac is praying for the will of God for his own life. And I know this, that happy is the man, and we've said it 1,000 times, happy is the man, happy is the person, who learns to want for themselves what God wants for them. Right? It is a wonderful thing and a beautiful thing when God brings our hearts around to begin to desire. Maybe right now in our lives as men, at the stage of life you are, no matter how hard you've run, no matter how many things you've done, you're at a stage in your life, hopefully, some of us men are at a stage in our lives where we are simply wanting for ourselves what God has always wanted for us. You know, it's like you burned away your young days, burned away those things, and now here you are in a place in life where all you want to do is be right before the Lord, right? Love your wife, be what you need to be in the lives of your children and your grandchildren. Be that man that God wants you to be, and you're wanting for yourself what God wants for you. And I say happy is that man, all right? And wise is that man when we begin to want that. And so prayer is one of those things where we learn to align our hearts up with the heart of God. Not bending the will of God, not talking God into something God doesn't want to do. Listen, you don't have one noble desire for yourself that God hadn't wanted for you before you wanted it. See? If you have a noble desire, a high desire for the things of God in your life, I guarantee you it was God by his Spirit who's been working to put it there. Right? So thank God for this. And we see this. We see that God's will is being done because Rebekah conceived. But we also see that Isaac's prayer is being answered because Rebekah conceived, and those two things are not mutually exclusive. It's not that Isaac gets his will done and somehow God didn't want it done, but Isaac talked God into it. It's not that God forced this upon Isaac and Isaac didn't necessarily want it. No, no, no. Isaac's heart met with God's heart. And the predetermined will of God and the prayer of Isaac met together. And Jacob and Esau are conceived. In verse 22, and the children struggled together within her, and she said, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went to inquire of the Lord. Now remember our point about prayer? Prayer is a means by which God gets his will done. Prayer is a means by which I get my heart lined up with God. Now watch this. I want you to see that Isaac in verse number 21, he is praying for his bride. What a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ Isaac is here, even in that. Remember, he's a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ in chapter number 22 when his father would sacrifice him on the Mount of Olives, right? I mean, on Mount Moriah. He's a picture of Christ. He's a picture of Christ as he waits for the Father to send the Spirit, and the Spirit brings back this bride to him. He's a picture of Christ. Remember that? And then Rebekah was brought back to him. He's a picture of Christ. He's a picture of Christ right here in his high priestly role of praying for us. And notice what Isaac is praying for Rebekah. He's praying that she would what? Bring forth fruit. You know what Jesus' prayer for you today is? That you bring forth fruit. that you would be fruitful. We're his bride. The church is his bride. He intercedes for us, and he's interceding for us that we might be fruitful. Herein is the Father glorified, that you bring forth much what? Fruit. John 15:8. The Father is glorified. And so we know that this is the will of God, my fruitfulness. And we see that Christ prays for that, our fruitfulness. Is it my desire to be fruitful? But we see Isaac praying for Rebekah in verse number 21. But now I love this, because now we see Rebekah praying for herself. Right? Does Christ pray for us? Yes. He intercedes for us. Should I pray for myself? Yes. And now notice, her question is a why question. Lord, why is it this way? Now, when I was a little boy, I was almost taught, you don't ask God why. Because God does what he wants to do, and don't you ask him why. Shut your mouth, boy. Don't be asking God no why. Right? Well, I don't know where we get that from. Because it's right for us to ask God why. Don't presume that you know the answer. Ask the Lord. Now listen, I will just say this. While we can ask God why, we cannot demand of him why. Right? So I don't think it's wrong to ask God why a certain thing is happening in your life. Why this or why that? Something that is a struggle. That's exactly what Rebekah did. She's got this inward struggle going on. And I told you that, by the way, God answered her. And so she's got this struggle going on. Two boys are in her, but not just two boys, but two nations. One boy is going to be the father of a nation, and another boy going to be a father of another nation, and these boys couldn't be any more different. And in fact, the idea is that they are opposed to one another. And there was this struggle. But that, what does that picture? Again, that picture's in the believer, that picture's in the church, that picture's the two natures that's in us. We're the bride of Christ, and I'm a Christian, and I know that, and I've got these two opposing natures in me. Right? I've got the new man, and I've got the what? Old man. You know what the new man is desiring for? The things of God. You know what the old man's desiring for? The things the old man is always desiring. And that's that nature. That's that struggle going on. Right? And it's the Romans 7 deal. Romans 7, Romans 8, Romans 7. The old man, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Who shall deliver me? When I want to do good, evil is always present. In my mind, I see it so clearly, but I can't pull it off in the flesh. It's Galatians 5. Where the spirit is lusting against the flesh and the flesh against the spirit. And these two are contrary, so that you cannot, without a battle, do the things that you would. There's always that battle. Can I get a witness? And the flesh with all of its appetites and its lust. And its desires, and the spirit with his fruit. And the flesh hates the spirit, because you know why? The spirit says you need to mortify the flesh. Mortify the deeds of the flesh. And the flesh saying, wait a minute now. Wait a minute. Who are you, new man? I've been here since 1960. The old man in my life been since 1960, December 60. The old man's been with me. Then the new man moves in on May 3rd, 1979, with all his desires for God. What is this? And not only that, the new man said, you got to go. You need to die. We need to mortify your deeds. And that's that you see that struggle. Well, she's got a struggle in her. And she asked why. And notice. God answers, verse 23, and the Lord said unto her, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one shall be stronger than the other, a people. And the elder shall serve the younger. That's a good word for us. Now notice in verse 24. And when her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb, and the first came out red all over, right, like a hairy garment. Right, that's old Esau. That's the old man. That's the new. That's the old man. That's the older. He comes out red. His name would later be called Edom, like Adam. Red man. See that? And he is a hairy man. Little boy born, you know, with hair all over it. And so he is obviously has a different look than the average baby, all right? Born look like a child of the wild. Red and hairy, like a hairy garment, the Bible says. His name is Esau. And after that came his brother out, and his hand took hold of Esau's heel. And his name was called what? Jacob. And Isaac was 80 years old when she bare him. He had been praying for this woman from the time he was 40. She was barren to the time he's what? 60. 20 years. Just keep on praying. Amen. 20 years, and finally she conceives, and finally she bears these children. And now you have Esau, the old red, hairy garment-looking kid. And you've got Jacob. And the Bible says about Jacob when he was born, doesn't talk give his physical description. It gives sort of a spiritual description. He was a heel grabber. Right? The word Jacob, he was a trickster, a deceiver, a heel grabber, one who will trip you up. Right? And so now you've got these two boys, all right? This is Isaac and his boys. And the boys grew. Now listen to this. And Esau was a cunning hunter, a man of the field. And Jacob was a plain man dwelling in tents. He was a mama's boy. So you've got that. You've got a boy like his daddy, an outdoorsman. You've got one boy who stayed around the house and cooked, and he's more like his mama, plain man, and so the plot thickens. These boys could not be any more different. Okay. I notice this. And now watch this, guys. Listen to me, dads. And Isaac loved Esau because he did eat of his venison. But Rebekah loved Jacob. You see how the plot is thickening here? You see how these boys born and they're so different, and one naturally gravitated toward the dad and the dad toward him, and one toward the mom and the mom toward him. And you see already now that there is set up in this house all of the groundwork for the confusion that's going to follow. And I just want to say this because this is a cautionary tale to every dad. You have to be careful, dad, because the Bible says Isaac loved Jacob because. And how easy it is for us to love one child over another because. Because he reminds you so much of your daddy. Or because he doesn't remind you so much of your daddy. Or because he plays football. You know how parents sometimes want to live their lives again through their children? Daddies do it and mamas do it. Mama wants to be the homecoming queen, so she begins to dress her little daughter up already as the homecoming queen. Right? They want to live vicariously through your kids. And if you're not careful, you have a kid who's not bent that way. Right? And you're trying to bend them that way, and their natural proclivities are for something different. Maybe you are a big, rugged football player, and you got a son who don't care a thing. He wants to play the piano. You don't want to play linebacker. That hurt. Play the piano. And you want to bend him toward the football field, and he doesn't care a thing about that football field. The stage is his deal, right? And dads have caused problems for their kids. Maybe this happened to you. Your dad wants you to go into business. You want to go into medicine. Your dad wants to go into medicine. You want to go to the mission field, right? I mean, parents, we have to be careful. Our children are a great stewardship to us. And just like every other thing God has put in our hands, a steward is a manager of someone else's resources. We have to manage that. And even now, like Matthew, man, you got these two babies. You know, it's a precious thing to manage that correctly. You pay your money. I remember there was a man sitting here who came and his daughter wanted to go to the mission field. He did not want her to go to the mission field. And I stood up and I said something similar to this. And he repented. He got his heart right with God, lined up with God, because it was God's will for that girl to go to the mission field. He had paid this good money for her education. He thought she ought to do this with this. But it was God's will for something else, and it was that being. And you know that verse. We know this verse very well, Proverbs 22:6, right? Train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart of. And that's not just talking about bringing him up in morals. You know what it's talking about? That children have a particular bent. They have this thing encoded in them. God's given it to them, whether it's the arts or the science or whether it's the speaking or what. I mean, whatever it might be, God has put that in them. And the best thing you can do is to take that little smoldering glimmer of a flame and blow it to a flame. Get it, fan the fire. Bring them up in the way that they should go. And then step back and then let them do what God has put in them. Right? I mean, I can go over to that piano. Is that piano in here? I can go to the piano and beat on the top of that piano and make a drum out of it. But come on, it's a piano. I can give you a rhythm beating on the top of the piano. But man, if I get over there to those 88 keys over there, is it 88? That ain't my bent. But if I play the radio, but anyhow, if I got over there to those keys and begin to tickle the ivories, then all of that, all that's in there, all that's been designed in it comes out of it, because it's fulfilling its purpose, right? Not me beating on the top of it, right? And so Isaac gets this boy, and he loved him because. And, you know, parent love has got to be. Listen, I want to tell you this. Train, ask God to give you grace so that your love can be love in spite of love, not love because of love. Ain't God's love a love in spite of love? We love him because he first loved us. He loved us in spite of the fact that we didn't love him. In spite of the fact that we do exactly opposite of what he requires of us and speaks to us about. So God's love is the initiative kind of love, and parents' love has to be that in the lives of their children. You don't put some standard on them to love them. Now, you put standard on them for behavior and expect them to live up to it, and then I'll tell you what, you better factor in grace for when they don't. Isn't that how God deals with us? I mean, the whole Bible, you have law and grace. Law is the standard. Grace is for when you don't keep it. So we thank God for the grace. And our kids need the same thing. And they don't need this, I need to perform kind of idea, or my parent won't love me. I've got to keep making this stupid stew. So this is what my parent loves. And if I don't do that, he won't love me. Isaac loved him because he made him this venison. But Rebecca loved Jacob. Now, this is not going to just put these, they're setting these boys up to be enemies. And it's not just going to cause problem in the boys, it's going to cause problem in them. It's going to be lying and scheming and conniving. So we see this, and the plot continues here. Now, let's move on a little bit. And Jacob sought pottage. Now, Jacob knew how to cook now. Because he hung around, and mama taught him how to cook. Rebecca knew how to cook. She taught this boy how to cook. Okay? If you got a son who loved to cook, just, hey, listen, he loved to cook. Okay? Just watch and see if he don't do this when he stirs the pot, though. Just try to work that out of him. No. But you know the truth of the matter is, listen to this. I'll say this. Listen to what I'm telling you. All of us see things in our kids, good and bad. Am I right? All of us see things in their lives where we know this is not the will of God for their lives. I'm not talking about personality things. I'm talking about character traits. I'm not talking about they're merciful or they're softer than the other brother. I had a brother who was softer than the rest of us brothers. He was a sickly boy, asthma, okay? And he didn't get out there and run and jump and play with the rest of us. So you know what we did? We call him a punk. We call him a fag. You know why? Because he wanted to be in the house. He was left-handed. He could draw. He could write. He could play the piano. He was just a finer kind of guy. You follow me? And we out there climbing trees and having China berry fights with the slingshots. You know, real fun stuff. Putting one another's eyes out. You know, and he's in the house. He's learning how to do, he's more domestic, and he just didn't run, jump, and play. And so what we did is we began to call him names. And you know what we did? And I found this out about my brother, and he told me this, and I want you to hear me. He told me he didn't have any homosexual tendencies until everybody began to suggest it to him. Now, he did. He died of AIDS. As a bisexual, just a confused person who going through this very precarious stage of sexual awakeness and awareness and all that, it was suggested to him by people. He got to be 19, he thinking, well, maybe I am. You be careful. I mean, I'm just telling you, it's very, very precarious, right? Very, very serious business of managing lives, stewarding over lives. And their little lives can be like blank checks. And what we write in there is what they cash out to be. So be careful, all right? And Jacob sought pottage. Esau came from the field, so he was a man in the field, and he was faint. I don't know whether this is how he always came home, tired and hungry, famished. And Esau said to Jacob, feed me, I pray thee, with that same red pottage, the stew you make, for I am faint. Therefore was his name called Edom, okay? He's old red man, a man at a moment. Rough and tumble guy. He comes home. He's tired. He's famished, apparently. I don't know whether he caught anything or shot anything, brought it home, but it wasn't cooked. And Jacob, there, man, he's got the place stunk up with this stew. And he says, give me some of that, man. I'm starving. And Jacob said to me, sell me this day thy birthright. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about the birthright. But the birthright, in the birthright in these days, there was a certain privilege and prominence and position and portion that went to the person who had the birthright. The person who had the birthright, usually the firstborn, would be the one who would be the family pastor. When the dad died, he became the patriarch and the family pastor, the family sage. So he had privilege and he had position. The double portion went to the birthright, to the firstborn. And so this birthright was important. Esau was the firstborn. Now Jacob tried to get him by the heel, right? But now Jacob is doing, he's stirring that stuff. He says, sell me this day thy birthright. And I want you to see in this passage, we won't get to it, we've got to close right now, but I want you to see the immediacy of how everything happens here. How quickly it happens in this particular passage. And that's the thing I want you to pick up about Esau. Because Esau is a picture in this particular passage of the flesh. He is the old man. And I want you to see that the old man wants to be indulged right now. That's your flesh and my flesh. And at that moment, it cares nothing about spiritual things. The most important things in the world can be compromised in a moment due to the appetite of the flesh. Whether that's greed or lust or, I mean, any number of things. Tell me this day. I want you to see and hear. Esau ate and drank. In the Bible, eating and drinking is a type of careless living. Right? Eat and drink, tomorrow you may die. Eat, I say to my soul, eat, drink, you have much goods for many years. Right? They were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage. Hey, that's a type of just careless living. I want you to see in this passage as you read, and we'll go into chapter 26 next week, but I want you to see that Esau, the Bible says in Hebrews 12, I think, 14, 15, 16, that Esau was a profane person. You know what a profane person is? They take something high and make it just commonplace. He took the blessing, which is a top shelf kind of issue in your life. You know, you put stuff on the top shelf to keep everybody from getting at it. He took this top shelf issue of his blessing, and he brought it right down to, I'll trade it for a bowl of stew. And the Bible says in Hebrews that he gave it all up for one morsel of meat, one morsel of bread, one meal, a man at a moment. Mr. Immediate, you know what I'm saying? I've got to get this done. And that's the flesh. And how many times have we, and we'll talk about this next week, I'm closing. How many times have we given up the precious things for some immediate deal? God help us. Now, this is a story for all of us. Amen? Amen. Story for all of us. Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you again for these men. Thank you for Matthew and for Rachel and for his precious Annie and Lydia. Thank you for them, God. Pray that you'd bless them, Lord, that we would be able to partner with this couple, God, and as they go to do that hard labor over in Pawpaw. And I just pray, Father, that these lessons that we've learned today around your word would resonate in our hearts, and that because of that, Lord, we would leave here with a greater awareness of who we are in our flesh and what you require of us, Lord, and that the new man is desiring the things of God for us, and that as we feed and as we nurture and as we fellowship and as we give attention, Lord, to the new man, that God, we will grow stronger and stronger and you would be glorified. So this is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.